Happy Tuesday, everybody. We're going to start this out listening to something special. This is probably one of the most beautiful arrangements I've ever heard in my life. During an era when strings were very popular, particularly in popular jazz. So give this a listen. Stop that right there. For me, it doesn't get any better than that. Strings, brass, soulful, whether you consider it R&B or jazz, popular jazz, just the lyrics, the instrumentals on that are everything, right? Super good stuff. That was Nina Simone, also known as the High Priestess of Soul. And she was given that title because when she performed, people said that the audience would lose all sense of space and time and they would be under her spell. So the name was appropriately given. She was born in Tryon, North Carolina in 33 to very religious parents, and she was a piano prodigy. So at the age of 3, she sat at the piano and could play almost anything she heard by ear. And with every year that passed, of course, she became more and more adept. Now, she didn't sing because her parents were so religious. Anything that didn't glorify God was considered the devil's music. So she was allowed to learn to play classical piano, obviously was insanely proficient. And in order to make a living, once she reached adulthood, she simply started teaching music to children in town. And things were tight, so she decided to supplement her income by going and working at a bar, playing popular music. But she changed her name at that time. So she had been born Eunice Kathleen Wayman, but so that her mother would not find out she was playing the devil's music, she changed her name to Nina Simone. So things started happening somewhat quickly for her at this point, right? And let me say this first. Nina Simone was a singer, songwriter, musician, and arranger, okay, as well as eventually a civil rights activist. So, with that said, she was known for her arrangements. She would take Porter and Gershwin tunes and put her own spin on them, and that really impressed people. She loved Bach, Chopin, Brahms, Beethoven, and Schubert. And in 1954, which is about the time she started singing in the bars, she recorded a 13-hour session. This was actually 2 years later for her first record deal. And it was just a straight 13-hour session. You went into the studio, you recorded with live musicians. There was no magic button that made you in tune. You laid it down and you got it right in its entirety, or it was scrapped, you know. And one of the most popular tunes that came out of that was My Baby Just Cares For Me, which y'all may remember Nat King Cole recorded and made very popular, as well as others. And things slowly started rolling for her, right? She reaches enough fame and popularity that in 1960, she's asked to perform at the Newport Jazz Festival, which was considered very, very prestigious at that time as it is now, right? And she came about sort of writing music and becoming a civil rights activist somewhat reluctantly. Now, let me explain what I mean by this. She held this mentality that her parents had preached to her, that anything that didn't glorify God was the devil's music, right? So she believed that. And when it came to civil rights and everything that was going on, she was like, how can you really communicate effectively what's going out and speak out in a 3-minute song? It seems sort of inept to her, right? This is a quote that she gave regarding the matter. Nightclubs were dirty. Making records was dirty. Popular music was dirty, and to mix it all with politics seemed senseless and demeaning. Until songs like Mississippi Goddamn just burst out of me, I had musical problems as well. Medgar Evers was a civil rights activist and was murdered during this time. This was also about the time that the 4 black girls died in the burning church that was set on fire in Montgomery, Alabama. So things are happening, and she wrote that song in a response to that, right? I'm going to play a piece of it for you now, and I'm not going to play it in its entirety. It's very, very intense, but I want you to listen to what she says in the beginning as she's introducing the song.
The name of this tune is Mississippi Goddamn. Mean every word of it. Alabama's gotten me so upset. Tennessee made me lose my rest. And everybody knows about Mississippi Goddamn.
This is the chorus that she repeats twice, then I'm going to play something else, and then we'll stop.
Tennessee made me lose my rest. And everybody knows about Mississippi Goddamn.
Listen. Somebody say a prayer. So things were really intense in the South as the civil rights movement gained momentum and things became violent. And she used music to speak out against that. So a lot of times when people hear that song today, they have no idea what it means. They just think it's sort of rebellious. And as you could tell, the crowd laughed when she sang that chorus through the first time. But it wasn't funny to her. And it wasn't funny to the people who understood what it meant, right? So over the course of her career, she produced over 40 albums. And she sang such great tunes as I Want a Little Sugar in My Bowl. If you haven't heard that one, punch it into YouTube. It's a favorite for me. And I'm Feeling Good, also very popular. You may know that one. But she spent 7 years with RCA. She had 2 songs that were Broadway hits in Hair. She spent the 70s and 80s touring Europe. In 1993, she moved to France. This is where she passed away in April of 2003. She has an autobiography out titled, I Put a Spell on You. I recommend that. I did not dig in to see if there's a film about her. If there is, by all means, please comment here. So people that prefer to see things, stories, and films can get a hold of that. And she said, I want to leave you with this, that as an artist, I feel it's my responsibility to make people feel on a deep level. And so she did everything that she could to make sure that people felt on a deep level when they listened to her music, whether it was in person or not. I know this is a brief mini lecture today, but I'm going to leave you with another beautiful song that I think very much depicts her, right? And sort of her speaking out about equality as well, which of course I love as a feminist. Here we go. Are you ready? They put commercials on her stuff. Oh, good, they didn't know. That's her on the piano. Hi, Willie. Hi, Christy. Hi, Lynn. Thank you for joining. Nina Simone, you can have him.
I don't want him. You can have him. He's not worth fighting for. Besides, there's plenty more where he came from. I don't want him. You can have him. I'm giving him the sack. And he can go right back where he came from. I'm afraid I never loved him. Sweetie, he'd be better off with you.
A truth teller.
I could never make him happy. All I ever wanted to do was run my fingers through his curly locks.
You get the gist. Today, the older they get, you get, the more you look like your mother, who was my best friend. Thank you for that, Willie. I take that as a compliment. And please know that I have recognized that over the last year. I've just sort of aged to this point in place where when I look in the mirror, I see my mother. Very much so. So thank you. That's very kind. And we love you so much, Willie. I will forever owe you for being there for her in the end. So that is Nina Simone. Today's little mini lecture is much shorter than the others. I'm going to try to get these to 10 to 15 minutes moving forward so people can join or go back and listen and don't feel like I'm sort of rambling and giving too much information. But today's dedicated to Nieve Malandra, who is a local entertainer and singer here in Las Vegas. When I first arrived in town about 7 years ago, I was following her, and I'd go hear her perform, and we were talking about our favorite types of music, and I told her I just love jazz and blues, and she said, who is your favorite singer of that genre? And I said, you know, for me, it's a toss-up. I said, Billie Holiday and Etta James are my favorite. And she said, what about Nina Simone? She goes, she's just incredible to me. She's my absolute favorite. And so it's because of Nieve that night that I sort of dug into Nina as I never had before. So today's show is dedicated to Nieve. There you go. You guys, tomorrow we are going to be covering Billie Holiday. And I'll play a few of her songs too, just excerpts from those. But today was Nina Simone, the High Priestess of Soul. And if you haven't been introduced to her music before, I highly recommend that you go on YouTube and listen to it. A phenomenal classical pianist, child prodigy, and great songwriter. All right. Happy Wednesday. Take care of you.